Today, we are just going to discuss about the design strength of a compression member. Means how much compressive force a member can or a section can take. There are various factors that affect the strength of a member, that is the compressive strength of the member, that depends upon the length of the member, cross-sectional area of the member, radius of gyration of the member, so on and so forth. We'll discuss one by one. First of all, we'll talk something in terms of the length. When we are talking in terms of the length of the compression member, it is required to calculate the effective length of the compression member. Generally, in the normal case, the length given is an unsupported length. That unsupported length is to be multiplied by some constant depending upon various boundary conditions at the ends of the column, and that can be seen through a IS code 800-2007 and already given in table number 11. You just go through the table number 11 and you will find four conditions are given. And there are two typical words which have been used. One is the translation and another is the rotation. When the displacement takes place, we call as the translation, and when it rotates like this, we call this as the rotation. So when any end is fixed and it rotates like this, we can call it is free in rotation, but it is not leaving its place, it cannot be displaced, so we can call this a restraint in translation, but not in rotation. Means when the rotation means when the movement is restricted, rotational movement is restricted, then we can say yes, it is restrained in rotation. When the displacement, whether it is this direction or is this direction, when the displacement is restricted, then we can say that it is restrained in translation. So neither the rotation is there nor the translation is there, we can say it is restrained both rotation as well as translation. And under such circumstances, various conditions have been mentioned. In all, there are 6 or 7 conditions are given in the code, but we are confining ourselves for only 4 conditions. Number 1, when both the ends are restrained in translation but not in rotations, means it is hinged. Another condition, in this case, of course, first of all, I will just inform you, when for this we have to find out some constant k. When this k is multiplied by that unsupported length of the column, that will give the effective length of the column. Effective length means nothing but when it is displaced like this, it buckles like this, this length is called the effective length of the buckling, and that is called effective length. So when the both the ends are hinged at the top as well as at the bottom, are restrained in translation but not in rotation, we can say the unsupported length, when multiplied by k, k is equal to 1, so we can say the effective length is equal to the unsupported length. Second condition, when this end is fixed, means restrained in not only in translation but also in rotation, and this end is restrained only in translation but not rotation. Here both the cases, translation as well rotation, are restrained, So when it, then it will start like this and then it will deflect like this. So right from here to here, the distance is, it is 65%. No, it is 0.8%. Yes, it is 80% of the total length. So value of K will be taken as 0.8. When both the ends, the top and bottom, are restrained not only in translation but also in rotation, the buckling will take only up to this position, and this distance theoretically it takes out to be 0.5, but practically it is taken at 0.65. When the one end is restrained in translation as well as in rotation and other end is free, then the value of K will be taken as 2. You need not to cram, you need not to remember, you can just go through the IS code, seeing the page number 41 of table 11, and you can straightway put the value for K and you can get the value of effective length of the column. So here we can find out the effective length of the column divided by the R. R is nothing but the radius of gyration. Some may call it the radius of gyration, but generally it is known as radius of gyration. Of each and every sectional member, you can find the radius of value of the radius of gyration is already given in a steel table. Now there are two values, radius of gyration, Rxx and Ryy. If not given, you can straightway calculate value of the radius of gyration R as Ixx upon A under root. Ixx is, you know, the moment of inertia and A is the area of this cross section. So I can say I by A under root will give the value of R. So Ixx upon A under root will give the value of Rxx. Similarly, Iyy upon A whole under root will give the value of Ryy. Similarly, in the steel table, Ixx is also given, Iyy is also given, area of cross section is also given. In addition to that, Rxx is also given, Ryy is given, Ruu and Rvv is also given, but you are not concerned with that. We are only confined to two, Rxx and Ryy. But the most important thing is we have to select the minimum of the two, Rxx or Yy, whichever is the minimum, this is to be selected as R minimum. So KL upon R, KL is nothing but the effective length of the column divided by the R minimum, that the radius of gyration which is minimum is known as slenderness ratio, which is denoted by lambda, Lambda is known as slenderness ratio and which is nothing but KL upon R. KL stands for the effective length of the column and R stands for the radius of gyration. In this case, we'll have to take the value of R as minimum of the Rxx and Ryy. But the most important as per the code is when we are talking in terms of the compression member, under any circumstances, effective length of column divided by the minimum radius of gyration should not be greater than 180, that is 180, that is 180. Under any, so that is the restriction given in the code also. Under any circumstances, if the KL upon R minimum exceeds 180, then you will have to change the section. So, once you know the value of KL and R, then find out the value of KL upon R. R means R again, I will repeat, I will nothing but R minimum, minimum Rxx and Ryy. Once we can find out this value, then it becomes very easy. You have to go for an important table, table number 9A to 9D. Question is, how to, which table is to be selected just to calculate value of the stress? For that we'll have to go for the class of buckling, buckling class. Class of buckling we have to select. Buckling class is to be selected. Again, while selecting the buckling class, we'll have to go through again important table, that is table number perhaps 10. I think it is perhaps this table number 10. I just wanted to confirm, you just go through that. For buckling class, it is given as table number 10. And then that will show under that condition, in which condition, I will say rather, whether it is buckling along which axis, A, B, C or D. That will show the buckling class. And according to that buckling class, now go through the table, that 9A, 9B, 9C and 9D. So if the buckling class is D, then you have to select 9D. If the buckling class is C, then you have to select 9C. Similarly, A and B also. That table comprising of first column comprising of the value of lambda, that is slenderness ratio, and other columns, series giving the value of Fy, starting to the end, right, from various values of Fy is given. From this, calculate the value of the required KL upon R value, the value of FCD, required stress, required compressive stress or required design stress. But not necessary, because the, suppose the value is given between, is KLR is in between 90 and 100, say 94. You won't find the value of 94 over there in the table. You will find 90 and you will find 100. So pick up the value of the 90 for given FY. Pick up the value of the 100 for the same given FY, interpolate it according to this. For that, if it is 94, interpolate for 94, pick up that value, that stress, which is called as FCD, which is already given in Newton per mm square. Newton per mm square. Now, this stress multiply by the area of the cross section, that was when the section is already given. We know the area of the cross section. This stress multiplied by this area of cross section will give the design compressive strength. Divided by 1000, you will get the result in kilonewton. You will get the result in kilonewton. This is, in short, we can find out the design strength of a given member when the length is given and the boundary condition is given. Now we'll try to solve a few, one problem. It is not available in the any textbook so far. I have selected the random values and just I am calculating. We are trying to calculate the value. We have to find out the compressive strength of an unequal angle section of 150 cross 75 cross 8. That is unequal angle section. Unsupported length is given as 4 meters. And the top and the bottom, both the ends are restrained in translation as well as in rotation. Now you can go through the steel table and you can find out when both the top and the bottom end are restrained in translation as well as the rotation, means that the K can be found out to be 0.65. Now what we have to do? First of all, we have to select the steel table. From the steel table, go through the unequal angle section table. Select the value of 150 cross 75 cross 8 and pick up the two values. One, the area of the cross section, and RXX and RYY. Once you can find out these two values, that is area of the cross section in mm square, rxx and ryy in mm, it might be given in centimeter, but you have to convert it into mm and you will find, then find out the ratio of kl upon r. When the both the ends are restrained in translation as well as rotation, means k value of k can be calculated. K, without calculation, they can see from the code 0.65. So we can find out the value of effective length LE. If we can find out the value of effective length LE, and from the steel table we can find out three values: area of the cross section, RXX, RYY. Yes, just see now. This is the angle section with area is given as 1742 mm square, RXX is 48.8 mm and RYY is 20.1 mm. Value of K is 0.65 as per the table number 11. As per table. Now from this now we can very easily calculate the LE, that effective length. Effective length is nothing but K into L. That is 0.65 into L is 2.6 meter, that is 2600 mm. 2600 mm. Now find out the lambda, that is slenderness ratio, because you know the value of RXX as well as RYY, which is the minimum? Definitely RYY is minimum. And you have seen already the value is 2600 meter, means 2600 mm. So K is 0.65 multiplied by this, this is 2.6, that is LE now. Now we have to find out the LE upon R minimum, that is 2600 divided by 20.1 will give the value of lambda. It comes out to be 29.35, and under, you have to see, under any circumstances it should not exceed 180. Under any circumstances, it should not exceed 180. Now, once we know the value of slenderness ratio, lambda comes out to 129.35, then for class of buckling, refer table number 11. Table number 11. Now, whether which class of buckling now? A, B, C or D, that we have to see. For angle section, the buckling class C from table number 9C, for FY taken as 300, it is already given over here. So FY is 300 and lambda or slenderness ratio is 129.3035. Pick up the value for 120 and 130. But the difference is very small towards the, that is 0.65. We can without any interpolation, we can go for the value of FCD as equal to, that's there for 130. So we can say it is 77.3. Now, once the stress is known, this stress, use the formula which is already given in the code itself. Stress into area will give the designed compressive strength. And when divided by 1000, that will give the result in kilonewton. So the total compressive force is 134.65 kilonewton. 134.65 kilonewton. Because the difference is very less, 0.65, so you need not to interpolate it. Straight we can pick up the value for 130. But it would have been somewhere in 24 or 126, something like this. Then you will have to make the interpolation and pick up the value in between 120 to 130. and substitute that value over here, multiplied by the, because this is already given in Newton per mm square, multiplied by the area will give the result in Newton, divided by 1000 will give it in kilonewton. This way we can calculate the various compressive forces or compressive strength or the design strength of any of the given minimum, but it is only applicable for a single sections, whether it is a single angle section, equal angle section or unequal angle section, whether it is a channel section, whether it is an I section or whatever it may be. But Rxx and Ryy is only applicable. Here we will find that every time you will find that Ryy is minimum for a single section. But if it would have been a composite section, that is more than one, that two angles are given or two channels are given or two I sections are given, then you will have to find out this value, and it is better to go for the Rxx and not Ryy. If time permits, we will try to prove that why Rxx is minimum when composite section is there. Otherwise, you just take the note of this, that when we are talking something in terms of the single angle section, when we are talking about the single angle section, Ryy is always be minimum for all sections. And when we are talking of the two sections joined together or placed back to back or face to face or with any condition, under that circumstances, Rxx should be taken as R minimum, although it seems to be the more. But we'll try to solve the problem if at all time permits us. Otherwise, you just consider why it is coming out to be taken as Rxx. Okay, we'll continue with some of the problems, more problem, and you will have a clear idea about how to find out the design strength for a compression member for a given section so far. After this, we'll design the compression member. Here we are calculating how much load is taken, how much load a member can take for a given length. But after this, will go in the reverse direction. Only load will be given, and for that load you will have to design the section. Maybe a single section, maybe a composite section or whatnot. We'll continue the same. We'll be meeting next time. Thank you very much.